We are going to be in conversation with Anand Radhakrishnan of Franklin Templeton. Needs no introduction. And the things that I would want to know from Anand, though, is what is his view over 2019, after rather tumultuous 2018 for almost all asset managers and all money managers? And what is the near-term holding in store for us? Anand, good having you. Thanks much for joining in. You know, I was listening in to a video that you guys had put out about 5-6 months ago about your estimates or your analysis of how the equity markets are doing right now. Back then you had said that Indian equity markets will depend on three things: global interest rates and liquidity, oil, and then a lot of other extraneous factors. 6 months out, how are those factors shaping up for the world markets and thereby for India?
Thanks for joining this chat. And yes, some of the macro global factors are still playing out. For example, global liquidity has become tighter as we speak over the last 6 months and 1 year. But the rates have become softer because of expectations of global growth has moderated. In that sense, I would say it was 50-50. While liquidity has become a bit tight, but the rates have moderated. Oil prices have moderated, which is good for an economy like India. And therefore, from a macro perspective, I would say two out of the three factors are definitely in favor of emerging market like India. I think probably what is holding back for investors at this point of time is more like what is the near term event like an elections would bring. And that's a macro event which global investors would like to wait and watch and take a call on that. But from an underlying economic perspective, I think we are in probably a better situation today than what we were about 6 months back or 9 months back, because some of the headwinds regarding oil price, current account deficit, and volatility of rupee has significantly moderated. And going forward next 6 months, one also assumes that such high volatile oil prices won't be again coming back. So some of the headwinds therefore have receded and has become a lot more moderate. And the economy also has gotten into a slightly better shape in terms of growth. And that you can see it in the way the banking sector credit has been growing. So we think that today we are in a much better situation from a macro perspective versus what we were about 6 or 9 month basis. Markets have also lost some bit of value during the time, making the valuations a lot more attractive today.
Interesting. Fast forward this to about 5 months out, Anand, and let's assume that elections don't hold in store any negative surprises from a market perspective, whatever that outcome is, and other things remaining the same. Would you believe that apples for apples, the indices should be higher than where they are right now, simply because of the factors that you pointed out? Low volatility in rupee, oil prices a lot more benign, and the big worry for emerging markets, which was a Fed which might have been hawkish, is now no longer looking hawkish. If any, it is probably sounding a lot more dovish than what it was. Would you believe apples for apples, the indices should be higher than where they are right now if the same situation persists 6 months out?
Definitely, and the current moderate situations, if they continue to hold on for next 6 months to 1 year, we would be in a much better situation from a industry perspective, from a market perspective. So there's no doubt about it. The only intermediate hump that we need to cross over is that of that political transition or the election related issues. I think once we are on the other side of that hump, we should be in a much better, clearer situation in terms of the nearer term outlook. The current benign conditions definitely suit inflows into emerging market like India, and we should probably see a much better outcomes post-elections.
You had mentioned one key point which I think everybody has addressed, that we were very top-heavy, very narrow market. While we can argue that a lot of these expensive stocks, or some of these expensive stocks, have come off, we were just looking at the YTD performance. The Nifty's held sway. The broader markets have continued to grind lower. 6-7% downticks for the mid-cap and the small-cap indices. Doesn't seem like that underperformance of the broader markets versus the Nifty is going away in a hurry. Do you think it'll last, or do you think that at some point of time in the next 6 months, people will make a beeline for the mid-caps and the small-caps because there genuinely might be value there?
Definitely, I do agree that this bipolarity of the market, where few stocks trade at a super normal valuations, whereas the rest of the market is grinding to a new low, cannot continue forever. One has to kind of look for where the value in the market lies on a continuous basis and keep avoiding pockets of overvaluation. There is no evidence at this point of time that all these overvalued or highly valued stocks are going to correct in unison at the same time. I think in my experience in the last 6 months, what I have seen is they are correcting to stock specific information. So valuations get reset as and when some of the nearer term growth drivers change or the growth numbers face some kind of a hiccup. So because some of them are priced to perfection, and if there is a small hiccup or a challenge, then the valuations get challenged as well. And it is happening at a stock level rather than as a basket of securities level. So we need to wait for individual stocks to kind of correct using going by their own fundamentals. In the meanwhile, I think the other part of the market where the significant value lies, which may be even within large caps or within mid and small caps, we need to kind of actively keep looking for the bargains. And some of them may have near-term growth challenges, but probably their valuations are a lot more accommodative of the near-term growth challenge than the other end of the market. So we need to constantly keep picking stocks from that end.
Okay. Let's talk about some of those as well. I was analyzing a couple of the larger funds within your portfolios and your holdings there. I see you are largely absent in NBFCs. In your large cap portfolio, yes, but you can argue that there are not too many large cap NBFCs, save for maybe a Bajaj Finance and some others. But even in your multi cap portfolio, I don't see NBFCs within the first 18-20 names. Are you circumspect of any kind of recovery coming in that pocket in the near term? And on the contrary, do you reckon that the NBFC stress is starting to come back again, which may not only harm that space, but other allied spaces as well?
We have generally been very cautious while we are investing in the NBFC space. We have had exposures to NBFCs which have very niche vertical like auto financing or mortgage financing, but we have never preferred a broadband NBFC which is doing multiple things simultaneously together, because our belief was that while niche players will continue to do reasonably well, bank-like NBFC will have challenges as and when the liquidity situation goes off and tightens. And that has been our primary thesis, is that try to look at where the firm has built a strong competency in a niche, and probably if you want to buy them, you can buy them subject to valuations being accommodative. But a broadband NBFC which kind of lends to multiple sectors, multiple niches, is something we have been pretty careful about. To kind of give a short answer to your question, we have been circumspect and careful about our investments in the NBFC sector. The current problems are twofold. Maybe one is on the fund side, on the liquidity side, where increasingly probably the sources of liquidity is getting narrower, and their ability to raise money from the wholesale bond market and debt market is getting challenged for various issues. It can be a simply liquidity issue. It can be a credit perception issue. But for whatever be the reason, I think the availability of funds definitely is going through some kind of a challenge. On the other side, we are also seeing some of the NBFCs who have lent to infrastructure, real estate, construction sectors have challenges in terms of having liquidity. So combination of both these two is creating some bit of a turbulence. We need to wait and see as to how this turbulence is handled by these companies, because this is the first time they are probably hitting an air pocket over the last 3, 4, 5 years. And how well they transverse through this air pocket and come out successful is something we don't have a great history to go by. So we need to kind of wait and see before we kind of decisively say that these are the ones which are kind of doing pretty well, and these are the ones which are not designed to take on such macro risks per se. So I would say that the jury is out, and it is better to wait and watch.
Okay. And that's a point well taken. I think you can probably extrapolate this to some of the other pockets too, and I'll come to those. But just while we're on the topic of NBFCs and absence from your portfolios, I see no large auto names as well. Is this a recent phenomenon after the NBFC crisis broke? Because frankly, if I go back to your previous answer about certain sectors which are structural in nature but have near-term challenges and valuations have corrected, I think autos fit right in that bill, right? Structural growth story, near-term challenges, valuations have come off by half or one-third. Why is it that you don't have exposure here?
No, we do have exposure to select auto, but yes, you are right that we are not negative on that sector. We do have a constructive view that the sector over a period of time will deliver good earnings growth and therefore good returns. Even the lack of availability of credit from NBFC may be a passing thing, because sooner or later, if there is a lending opportunity, if not NBFCs, banks will come and fill that void, because it's a profitable lending opportunity, and therefore the industry won't be devoid of funds or devoid of credit, which is required for growing that. So if you look through the near-term turbulence, there is definite value in whether it is a two-wheeler stock or a commercial vehicle stock or even cars. We might see good value at this juncture. We might be looking to buy stocks as we speak in that space. Currently, we have select exposures in some of the CV manufacturers and two-wheeler manufacturers.
Okay. One final question, because I'm sure you have a busy time ahead. What did you make of the budget focus on consumption? And, two-part question to that as well. I heard a very interesting comment from somebody on the sell side about how it's very difficult to predict what a move of this nature will elicit in terms of a response from the people who get the money in the first place, whether it be pure play staples expenditure or something else. And even if it is largely believed that the spend will be around food and staples, etc., valuations maybe in this space are prohibitive. You too, as I see your blue chip fund, none of the large cap staple names are present in your top holdings, at least the top 15-20 holdings in your blue chip fund at least. So what's your sense about what the budget did for that pocket and what's the outlook for that pocket?
So budget has clearly had some elements which increases the income, disposable income in the middle class. Now that is a clearly we are getting in terms of taxes benefits, in terms of benefits for housing, interest expenses, interest earned, there is a higher ceiling now. So there are clear benefits for a middle class, but as you said, what they are going to spend on it is a bit of a conundrum. From my own understanding of a long period trends, just because there is a higher income, people don't buy higher and more soaps or shampoos or detergents, they probably end up spending on more consumer durable. They probably kind of take a little more risk and probably buy a house, because now you have 20,000-30,000 more money to spend annually, and if they can help you to borrow 20 lakhs and pay EMI for it, in all likelihood, you will probably, the decision which you are postponing for months together or years together in terms of owning a house or owning a car, you will probably spend that money. It's very unlikely or less likely that you are going to buy more hair oils or shampoos with that disposable income. However, the same thing cannot be said for the efforts towards increasing rural income. The efforts which the government makes in increasing the rural disposable income will have an impact on consumer staples growth, etc., because those are aspirational, those are under-penetrated in that segment, and we would see them buying more branded goods, more consumer staples there. But as I said, that you have to eventually see whether it is going to structurally lead these companies to go to much higher growth path than where they are now. I would say no. At the margin, at the increment, this may push you and pull you in a particular direction. But that still doesn't take away from the fact that some of these companies are trading at a 2-standard deviation than their normal valuation, and therefore the valuation comfort not being there is a primary concern for us. They might go through 1% or 2% higher growth in the near term, but that doesn't provide enough cushion for the valuation stretch.
Okay, final question. Anything that keeps you worried about the equity markets? It could well be a function of what's happening to the NBFCs or the bond markets. And you know, a lot of people have been speaking about how is it that AMCs will deal with issues such as Z, which have cropped up, or issues such as DHFL, which have cropped up, because they are, while they may be considered as black swan events, they're happening all too frequently now over the last 6 months. What is your personal opinion on what happens to, you know, an issue like Z or a DHFL? I'm not asking for a specific comment on a Z or a DHFL, but that kind of issues.
So clearly, the events like this have a tendency to have contagion effect. The simplest response is one of risk-off trades. So most portfolio managers will look to cut risks or at least incrementally not take risks. So to that extent, I think what will happen is the nature of investments which are going to do well or which are going to get money over the next 3-6 months is going to be significantly different than what got money in the last 1 year or 2 years. So there is going to be inter se reallocation of money or at least the incremental money which will happen. That is the easiest thing to predict. The tougher thing to predict is how the situation disentangles itself, what kind of intervention it is requires from various people who are involved, including regulators. And it's a very, very fluid situation for us to take a call. But we have to be mindful that the situation neither should snowball, because if it snowballs, it becomes very big issue to manage. Neither does it have a contagion effect on adjacent areas like banks on one side, on other kind of financial services on the other side. So the contagion and snowballing effect need to be taken into account when we are kind of handling the situation. It is not an easy place to be in at this juncture.